Good morning. I want to hear you. Good morning. Good morning. Yes. All right. Let's start with hymn number 195, Showers of Blessing.
There shall be showers of blessing. This is the promise of love. There shall be seasons refreshing, sent from the Savior above. Showers of blessing, showers of blessing we need. Mercy drops round us are falling, but for the showers we plead. There shall be showers of blessing, precious reviving again. Over the hills and the valleys, sound of abundance of rain. Showers of blessing, showers of blessing we need. Mercy drops round us are falling, but for the showers we plead. There shall be showers of blessing, send them upon us, O Lord. Grant us to now a refreshing, come and now honor thy word. Showers of blessing, showers of blessing we need. Mercy drops round us are falling, but for the showers we plead. There shall be showers of blessing, oh, that today they might fall. Now as to God we're confessing, now as on Jesus we call. Showers of blessing, showers of blessing we need. Mercy drops round us are falling, but for the showers we plead.
Our opening hymn today is hymn number 600, Hold Fast Till I Come. Will you please stand for our opening hymn?
Sweet promises give to all who believe. Behold, I come quickly, mine own to receive. Hold fast till I come, the danger is great. Sleep not as to others, be watchful and wait. Hold fast till I come, sweet promise of heaven. The kingdom restored to you shall begin. Come, enter my joy, sit down on my throne. Bright crowns are in waiting. Hold fast till I come. We'll watch unto prayer with lamps burning bright. He comes to all others, a thief in the night. We know he is near, but know not the day. As spring shows that summer is not far away. Hold fast till I come, sweet promise of heaven. The kingdom cheer my joy. Sit down on my throne. Bright crowns are in waiting. Hold fast till I come.
Yes, this is our hope.
'Tis built on His word. The glorious appearing of Jesus our Lord.
A promise is all.
It stands as the psalm. Behold, I come quickly. Hold fast till I come. Hold fast till I come. Sweet promise of heaven, the kingdom restored to you shall begin. Come enter my joy. Sit down on my throne. Bright crowns are in waiting. Hold fast till I come.
God, I want to thank you for today, for your holy Sabbath, a chance to know you a little more, to rest in a day that you have set as time began. God, I pray today that you'll bless our families as we lead them to you, as we put them in your hands, our hurts and our wants, and some of the things that we just can't control. I pray that we will bring them to you today, and that we'll rest in the knowledge that you are God who wanted a Sabbath with us so that you could carry us and be there for us. In your holy name, amen.
Heavenly Father, you always amaze me. Let your kingdom come in my world and in my life. Give me the food I need to live through today. And forgive me as I forgive the people that wrong me. Lead me far from temptation. Deliver me from the evil one. I looked out my window. The birds are composing. Not a note is out of tune or out of place. Walked to the meadow to stare at the flowers, better dressed than any girl on her wedding day. So why should I worry? Why do I freak out? God knows what I need. You know what I need. Your love is strong. Your love is strong. Your love is strong. The kingdom of the heavens is now advancing. Invade my heart, invade this broken town. The kingdom of the heavens is buried treasure. Would you sell yourself to buy the one you found? two things you've told me, that you are strong and you love me. Yes, you love me. Kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us weary sinners. Keep us far from our vices and deliver us from these prisons. Your love is strong. Your love is strong.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. Today the offering fund is for the Kansas Nebraska Scholarship Fund. We believe that Christian education meets the needs of our youth as an essential part of our mission. This fund was started in 2010 by the constituency of the conference after closing one of our last boarding academies. It provides a way to partner with parents and students who want a Seventh-day Adventist secondary education but don't live near one of our academies. Each year since 2010, the Kansas-Nebraska Scholarship Fund has enabled about 50 students to attend an Adventist boarding academy in one of our sister conferences. While much of the money in the scholarship fund comes from the sales of crops from the academy farms, the contributions of members make up a significant portion of the amount awarded each year. Because of your generosity, support of the Kansas-Nebraska Scholarship Fund, our day academies and elementary schools, who also receive support from this fund, which helps students attend their local academy and elementary or secondary schools. Let us return today a faithful tithe to the Lord and give this generous offering to support Christian education for our youth through the Kansas-Nebraska Scholarship Fund. Would the deacons please rise? Our most gracious Heavenly Father, we pray a blessing on the special fund so that children can have a Christian education and to learn more about you through the schools and the teachers that go there to teach them. We pray that you will multiply the offering and that you will bless each and every person who gives and the teachers that teach. Thank you for your wonderful and blessing to us. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
In the dark of the midnight, have I oft hid my face while the storm howls above me and there's no hiding place. Mid the crash of the thunder, precious Lord, hear my cry, keep me safe till the storm passes by. Till the storm passes over, till the thunder sounds no more, till the clouds roll forever from the sky. The storm passes by. When the long night has ended and the storms come no more, let me stand in thy presence on that bright, peaceful shore, in that land where the tempest never comes. Lord, may I dwell with thee when the storm passes by. Till the storm passes over, till the thunder sounds no more, till the clouds roll forever from the sky. Hold me fast, let me stand in the hollow of thy hand. Keep me safe till the storm passes by.
Happy Sabbath. Welcome to Piedmont Park Seventh-day Adventist Church. We are a couple of pastors short, but we traded those ones in for another one today. But just don't tell them that. When they get back, just act normal. A few announcements here. Let's see. Today, after church, we are having a very special get together. I hope the weather is nice today because we're going to be spending a little bit of time outside, right? There is a picnic over at Antelope Park. It looks like it's about 1:30. So after church, is it 1:30 that we're eating? Okay, so the picnic is at 1:30, and then after the picnic, did you have something you wanted to say about that? All right, come on up.
Actually, the person that knows the most about it is sitting right up here in the third row. Would you come up, Sue? We'd like to say several things. First of all, the first time I was up here talking about God and shoes, I told everybody how to save money on airfare because they don't have to travel to a faraway mission site to do this mission project. So today I'm going to tell them how they can save all that time and money, what they can do with it. Because, you know, air travel does take a lot of time. So my brother just got back from Honolulu, and it took him 28 hours because of plane problems. So we won't have that problem just going here in Lincoln. So I'd like you to tell us about what we can do with our time and our money that would support God in shoes. I can tell you what I've already done and what I know some people are doing. I know that Tom Randa from the Good Neighbor Center invited all of the agencies that are represented on the Homeless Coalition, and for those of you that are involved with nonprofits here in Lincoln, we have more than 200 nonprofits, and maybe about 50 of them are involved in that coalition, and he invited all of them and all of their clients. And I invited the women that go to the swimming event for Muslim women on Friday evenings at Union College. There were 75 there last week, and those are being invited. So we have a lot of invitations going out. So I'm going to give it to you and have you tell us what you need from us in the way of time, talent, and money.
Well, yes, thank you. This is a mission trip right here at home in our own backyard. You know, folks, if we don't take care of our neighbors, who will? They're not going to do a mission trip to Kansas, Nebraska. Jesus has left this mission field to us. So we have an opportunity this Sabbath afternoon. 1:30 is the picnic in Antelope Park. We're going to have a meet there, eat, and then have a special time of prayer. Then we're going to pair you up 2 by 2, English and Spanish speaking, because you don't know when you go to the door if they're going to say hola or hello. Either way, we're equipped. So we're going to pair you up 2 by 2 to go door to door, and this is what you're going to give them. This is a flyer that shows all of the events in God and Shoes that will be beginning Sunday, September 13 through Sunday, September 20. We need your help as far as people to help run the games that we'll be doing at Antelope Park on Sunday, September 13th. Everybody is invited. There is something for everyone to do. We have families that have come in the past. Their kids have helped. If you are an able-bodied person, please come. Wear your best smile and know that you are welcoming friends for Jesus into each one of our events. You know, sometimes we box God into thinking, well, witnessing has to be a Bible study, or witnessing, it has to happen in a certain way. But you know, God is not boxed in by our thinking. He is open, and he doesn't call people who feel like they're qualified to do it. Matter of fact, if you feel you're qualified, you're not. God is the one that's qualified, and he equips each one for the things that he wants us to do. So I'm inviting you to just show up and say, I'm available. Once again, our fun day, we need people to help with the games that we're inviting people to come play. At the park, we'll be serving picnic lunch all day long, and so we need your help there. You know, at other family fun days, I've had people ask, you know, what church does something like this for their community? You know, it's we have to make friends and win people's confidence before they want to hear anything about our religion. But if they can tell that we care about them, you know, they're much more likely to hear what we would like to share with them about Jesus and the gospel. So I invite you to become part of this Sunday, September 13. Monday to Thursday evenings, we have seminars and suppers right here in the Piedmont Park Church. We'll be having a series of different educational and helpful topics. And each evening we have inspirational presentations by pastors each evening. We have childcare that we're providing. So we need people to help with the childcare. We need people to help with registration. Vanessa Schecker has been just on top of this and lining up people to help with that. But if you'd like to help, please contact her. Then on Wednesday and Thursday at the Center for People in Need, we are participating in what they call truckloads of help. This is sorting healthcare items and household goods. We need people to help us with that. It's 8 to 12 Wednesday and Thursday mornings and 1 to 3 p.m. on Wednesday and Thursday afternoons. Then on Sunday, September 20, is our Ladies Spa Day. Now, you may think, okay, men, don't shut your ears here because you're invited to help as well. Your help is needed in the childcare area. You can do it. My husband took care of our 4 kids when I went to retreats as a young mom. And so I know men can take care of kids and do it very, very well. So we need your help. Ladies, we need your help. Thank you to all those who have signed up already. We have a good group of people that are going to be giving the spa services, the facials, the manicures, the foot baths and moisturizing. We still need people to help. We need people for registration on that Sunday, and that's noon to 5. If you're doubtful, you say, well, I don't know how to give a facial or things like that, Now, ladies, this is your department, and this is where you will be trained. My assistant, Susan Swigert, is a cosmetologist. She'll be here on to train you that Sunday morning if you would like to help with the facials or the manicures foot baths. She'll train you, so don't worry. Just come and get the training. Most of all, we need people with listening ears at the spa. The ladies come in excited about the things they're going to receive, but as they receive the massage, they start to relax, and they start to tell you the challenges they're facing in their lives. And it's the easiest thing ever to say, would you mind if I prayed with you about the things you've just shared with me? Now that person's just entrusted me with something, and the friendship begins, and they're open, and the whole room becomes a house of prayer. It is a marvelous thing to see. But we are providing childcare. We could not have the spa without childcare. So I'm serious, men. We need your help on that during those hours. Also during the evening seminars, we have to have childcare. We are giving welcome baby baskets to mothers who have children 1 year and younger. And we need, I call it a basket with a friend. The moms in the church, we need you to, those of you who are willing to say, I will be a mentor, I will become a support, I will become a resource mom in the community. You exchange phone numbers. You just call them once in a while. This is not to tell them what to do. It's to listen and to support and encourage. And if you're a mom, you know exactly what I'm talking about. So some of these moms, many of these moms have no family. They're out on their own. They're a single mom. They don't even know what a happy, healthy family looks like. This is what I'm asking you to do. Please become a mentor mom. And what you have to do is just be here Monday through Thursday evening. At the close of the evening, we'll be giving out these baskets. And we'll just ask you to exchange your phone number with someone. It's a wonderful opportunity to build a friendship. To support these moms. So if you have any questions, I'm happy to answer them, and I'm sure I've taken way more than a lot of time. I'm not sure what that time was, but you know, it's really scary. You give me a microphone and tell me to talk about God in shoes. It's difficult to stop. But I hope this gives you an idea of some things that you can do. We still need some supplies. We need some lotion. I think we're about 100 short at this point on the lotion, but it's amazing to me every year. Somebody asked me, I was at College View for first service, and somebody said, so are you ready for God in shoes? And I said, he is. And that's really the only thing that matters, isn't it? And the rest of us just show up to be available for the ride and to do whatever he calls us to do. And we need 13 pairs of shoes. Isn't that awesome? Out of 500, we need 13. So we praise the Lord for that. We praise the Lord for the donations that have come in. I never know, you know, this is truly a walk of faith. We never know who's coming, how many are coming, but God does. That's why I say it doesn't matter if I'm ready. He's ready. He knows who we need to touch. He's more anxious and eager to do that than we are. So I'm just asking you, if you're willing and available, we have a work for you to do. God has a work for you to do. Thank you so much, and I hope you can join us this afternoon. One important thing is, right, some of you, many of you may want to go and support Chris at the funeral, the memorial this afternoon at 3:30. Now, I'm going to be back at that table in the lobby, and if you are not able to go with us this afternoon, please see me. We'll give you a territory. And some of these, you can go tomorrow, okay? Don't have to do it this afternoon. So you can be free to go to the memorial. But please, if you take some of these flyers, we're marking that territory off. They will not be contacted unless you do it. So please don't take them and then say, I don't have time. Make sure you cover that territory so those people get invitations as well. Thank you, and God bless you for what you've already done. I see many faces out here that have already spoken to me, say, I'll help with the fun day, I'll help with the spa, I can be at the Center for People in Need. So thank you, and God bless you, and I'm excited to see what God wants to do through you during God in Shoes and for the people of Lincoln.
Thank you very much.
All right, a few more things here. If you are going to be working at the welcome desk, that nice shiny new desk we've got out there. It's probably drawing a lot of attention. Everybody's saying, yeah, I'd sit behind that desk. Well, if you're going to be working at that desk here this next year, please meet after church for a short meeting to sort of, I guess, strategize and come up with a plan for the welcome desk for this coming year. Soup, supper, and guitar vespers, which has been a tradition here for the last few years, will start up again on September 6th. That is a Sabbath evening at 6 p.m. Okay, September 5th, not 6th. I guess go by that. And also our church campout, which is also another tradition that's been going on for a while. Is on October 2nd through the 4th. And I think that'll also have something to do with our Pathfinder and Adventure Club. Did you have an announcement you want to make? Sounds like we've got some registration coming up for that.
If you guys remember last week, Pastor Halfhill told me I only had 60 seconds. And I don't know if you saw, he was actually creeping up on me as I was talking. I think he was ready to pull me off the... But if you've ever been a Pathfinder before, you know we don't do things halfway. So I just wanted to kind of let you know, we had our registration last Sunday for all of our youth clubs, for our Little Lambs, our Eager Beavers, our Adventurers, and our Pathfinder Club. We had a great turnout. There was ice cream, there was tents. Yes, there was tents set up in the Fellowship Hall. It was awesome. And I want you to know that if you didn't have a chance to come, I've had some people contacting me already saying that they missed it. You can still come at 6:30 on Wednesday night and get registered for those clubs. So all the way from, are the Youngs here? No, okay. Little Lambs, I think they're doing three, maybe. Is it three? Yeah, I think they're doing so three all the way up. And Pathfinder starts in fifth grade. So, and really, we've got some great opportunities for teens that still want to be part of what we're doing. And college students, I'm looking at some over here. We've really got a need for some counselors and some volunteers to come help, and it's a great opportunity to serve. So I want to talk about the importance, I think, of Pathfinders. A lot of people say, are the skills still needed? The confidence is still needed in children today. And the connection with Jesus is definitely still needed. We're going to focus a lot on, we got a big canoe trip this summer. So yeah, we're going to put kids in the water. We're going to teach them how to balance a canoe, how to paddle a canoe. We're going to teach them how to tip their friends, things like that. And you may say, well, why do they need to know how to do that? Well, I'll tell you what, it's very important for the confidence that they have. I'm disturbed. I see my children. So it used to be play video games, right? I was worried about kids playing video games. But now I see my children. Sometimes I'm like, what are you doing? He's like, oh, I'm watching a YouTube video of a guy playing video games. I'm like, you're living vicariously through somebody who's living vicariously through the video game? That disturbs me greatly. We got to get out. We got to start doing things. And I'm excited to be part of Pathfinders here at Piedmont. We've got some great new gear. We got great new tents. We've got a lot of great things happening this year. And I just encourage you to give us a chance. So if you've got any questions, find me. I'm the guy that, believe it or not, still fit in his uniform somehow. If you want to learn how that worked, let me know. And we'll talk. So I think that's all I got. Thank you very much. Wednesday night, 6:30, show up. Thank you.
All right, thanks. And Pastor Michael's not here, so we won't tell him how long you took this week.
Good morning. This morning we have the opportunity, as our last few children are going back to their seat, to welcome a new student pastor. Here at Union College, we have a long tradition of connecting with, or I should say here at Piedmont Park, we have a long tradition of connecting with Union College and allowing one or two of their students to come up here to Piedmont Park during their senior year and get an opportunity of what ministry is really all about in a local church. And so this morning we're happy to welcome our student pastor, Josh Hester. And while he's coming here and we have an opportunity to hear a few things about him, we won't squeeze too much of his precious sermon time from him, but while he's sharing just a little bit about his background, I'd like to invite the elders, if they would, to come forward, and also our religion chair, Elder Bob Frederick, if he would also come forward. And we want to pray for Josh as he gets started here in Piedmont Park, that his ministry and his learning experience would be blessed by God and be guided by God, and that he would be equipped, even as he is equipping us for ministry, he himself would be equipped for ministry where God leads him in his church field for the kingdom of God. So tell us, Josh, just in 30 seconds, where are you from and what brought you here this morning to Piedmont Park?
Wow, okay. I'm from Oregon originally. I went to school at Gem State Academy. I went to Union College, which brought me here. I went to Union College because I loved the small town feel around the college, yet there was enough to be able to buy what I needed and do things. And I love that most of my best friends and the people I love most in the world are here. And so I'm glad to be here. And I'm also glad I got to be at Piedmont Park because you guys have been super nice to me the past week. It's my first week here, so pray for me and help me that I might learn and grow. But I've really had a great time, so I'm glad I'm here.
All right, thank you so much. Welcome to Piedmont Park. Elders, please gather in around. Let's pray for Josh that his ministry here would be a blessing to us and that he would be blessed and equipped as he learns himself God's calling on his life. Holy Father, we're so thankful for the local church because this is where ministry happens. And as we have an opportunity here in our local church, Piedmont Park, to welcome Josh Hester to our midst, we pray that your spirit would work powerfully through him on our behalf and on your behalf for your kingdom. May we learn from him, and may he learn from us, and may our joint experience throughout this next year be powerful for the kingdom of God. We want to reach this community, and we want to help in the training of the pastors that you bring our way as they are preparing to go out into the world field. Thank you for this opportunity, and may your spirit work mightily in this young man, we pray, in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Thank you, Josh. Thank Welcome you. To Piedmont Park.
Oregon. Yes, sir.
Happy Sabbath once again. How many of you are happy because you realize that we are loved? Are we not? And let us go ahead and stand as we sing our opening. Jesus loves me. Praise God that we are loved.
I was lost, I was in chains, the world had a hold of me. My heart was a stone, I was covered in chains. When he came for me, I couldn't run from his presence. I couldn't run from his arms. Jesus, he loves me. He loves me. He is for me. Jesus, how can for me. I was a fire deep in my soul, and I'll never be the same. I stepped out of the dark and into the light when he called my name. I couldn't run from his presence. I couldn't run from his arms. Jesus, he loves me, he loves me, he is for me. Jesus, how can it be, he loves me, he is for me. He opens doors and he holds my heart with healing. Where he died for me, a lonely hope, my everything. Jesus, he loves me, he loves me, he is for me. Jesus, how can it be, he loves me, he is for me.
Please kneel with us as we sing our prayer song, There is a Redeemer.
Father God, thank you for the Sabbath day. Please bless all the people have come to worship you today. Thank you for the new lobby and our growing church community. Please take care of all things here at Piedmont Park Church. We ask you to bless all who are sick and ask that you heal them. We also remember the families of Fred Muir and Jacob White today. Please forgive us our sins. Help us to be more like Jesus Christ. We ask that you will bless pastors and be with Pastor Josh as he preaches today. Thank you so much for the Sabbath, and we love you, God, every sight, every single day. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. Our scripture reading is from Matthew 5, verses 1 through 10. And seeing the multitudes, he went up on a mountain, and when he was seated, his disciples came to him. When he opened his mouth, he taught them, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are they who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the meek, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be sons of God. Blessed are they that are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." May the Lord add his blessing to his word.
Ooh. Hello, church. Give me a second as I get this all set up real quick. I think that'll help us the rest of the afternoon. Well, I want to start off by saying this is my first time here, as you all know, and it's also been weird. It's the first time I've ever been called pastor anything, ever. But it does remind me of a couple things, and one of those is definitely that I am not the pastor of this church, but neither is Pastor Michael Half Hill. He's a great pastor, but really we want to remind ourselves that Christ is the pastor here. And maybe for my own nerves, I'm reminding myself of that. I also want to thank you guys to let me be here. Today we're going to do what I like to title A Sure Way. And with any pathway, with any direction we're going to go, there's always what you could call, I actually did a similar version of this, and I called it the debut. And I focused on a different aspect, and that was that with any entrance of ministry, with any first time, there's always the debut. There's the moment, the cast, the direction setting. And that's what we're going to talk about today. So we see Jesus. We're actually going to talk in Luke 6 right now. So if you could turn there. I don't know how. Oh, yeah, you can probably read that. So it says this. Jesus came down with them and stood on a level place, and there was a large crowd of his disciples and a great throng of people from all Judea and Jerusalem and the coastal region of Tyre and Sidon, who had come to hear him and be healed of their diseases. And those who were troubled with unclean spirits were being cured, and all the people were trying to touch him, for power was coming from him and healing them all. So at first Jesus was kind of becoming a pretty big deal. If I started walking around Lincoln and Omaha and started traveling, healing everyone I saw, you might be inspired to say, there's something kind of big about this guy. He's a little different than anyone else I know. Maybe I should figure out what he's doing. But before we really get into what the actual teaching was, I want to kind of set the table, okay? We're going to set the table and figure out the context a little bit. This is in Luke, and the reason, this is the verse right before the Beatitudes are taught in Luke, okay? And it gives us a little emphasis that Matthew doesn't give. I want you to notice what I highlighted. And there was a large crowd of his disciples and a great throng of people. In Matthew 5, it says this, verse 1, and seeing the multitudes, he went up on a mountain, and when he was seated, his disciples came to him. Then he opened his mouth and taught them, saying. Here, at the very end, it actually says that he looked up to his disciples and began teaching. So I want to bring out a point here. Let's pretend that you five lovely people are what we're going to call the disciples, okay? Can you all be disciples? You're disciples, and you are what we would call the multitude. So there's the disciples, and there's the multitude. Jesus is walking around, and he's healing everyone. Bah, bam, people are raising from, you know, they're doing amazing things. Jesus is doing awesome things, and everyone's following him, okay? Then Jesus gets to a mountain, and his disciples and his multitude are there. And he raises his eyes, it says in Luke, to his disciples and begins teaching. It's interesting that the very first time Jesus preaches in a public way in this manner, he makes both Luke and Matthew make a point to show us there are two groups, and Jesus is teaching his disciples in front of everyone else. In other words, he's teaching the people who are going to take the church over after he's gone. He's teaching them how they need to be, and he's doing it in front of everyone else. He's kind of setting a tone, giving an emphasis, okay? I wanted to point that out. This was what we might call a course-setting moment. It's a big deal. Now, all of us know about the presidential election that's going on right now. There's a big process, a lot of craziness, and I like Ben Carson in how he became known. I want to emphasize that. You see, Ben Carson was a well-known neurosurgeon, an incredible man. But no one would have even thought that he could be president until this moment. Does anyone know what's happening in this picture? He's at the prayer breakfast. You see, Ben Carson was willing to go almost blatantly against Obama while Obama was sitting 3 feet from him. That's kind of a big deal. And what do you think he's known for today? He's known for having different ideas than Obama and being able to go against all the other politicians. That's what his whole entire presidency, his whole candidacy is based on. That's because he was known for that. That's because that's what he got famous for. Anyone else? Are there any sports fans in here? Football fans? Basketball? I think I'm safe with football fans with the Huskers around. Okay, but we're going to talk about basketball today. This is a list of the rookies of the year, okay? It starts back in like the 40s, but I highlighted the more recent years for our sake. starts in 92 and goes all the way to 2015. It gives the rookie of the year for that year, and it just gives us the full list, what country they're from and what team they played for, what position they were. And you can't really tell here, and maybe some of you can, but a lot of them are kind of highlighted a darker bluish tint. All of those ones that are highlighted a darker bluish tint are players who, after they were the rookie of the year, went on to become extremely famous players. If you know anything about basketball, names like Kevin Durant, Derrick Rose, Kyrie Irving, Chris Paul, LeBron James, they're kind of the players in basketball today, okay? These were all players who the rookie year that they played were incredible, and everyone recognized it, so they made them the rookie of the year. They then went on to become MVPs, the stars of their teams. So we can kind of see, even in the sports world, if you're a really talented player, everyone can kind of see it, and they kind of know where you're going to go. Does that make sense? They're kind of starting a course their first year. This is a video, and if you've ever seen, if you don't know the name Susan Boyle, you'll kind of get what I'm talking about. And I want to apologize, she does a little hip thrust there. She's not the most like seductive woman, so I hope you don't take it the wrong way. But I just want to make a good point, and I think you'll enjoy it, okay? Oh, do we have sound on it? Is the sound ready? Okay, there we go.
How old are you, Susan?
I am 47. And that's just one side of me.
Sorry. Sorry.
Okay.
I dreamed a dream in time gone by.
Without a doubt, that was the biggest surprise I have had in 3 years on this show. When you stood there with that cheeky grin and said, I want to be like Elaine Page, everyone was laughing at you. No one is laughing now. That was stunning, an incredible performance.
Okay, moment of truth. Here's yes or no.
The biggest yes I have ever given anybody.
Amanda?
Yes, definitely. Brilliant.
Amanda, you too!
Susan Boyle, you can go back to the village with your head held high. It's three yeses.
Now, I share that partially just because it's a cool story. So we see with Ben Carson, he starts a trend. It's kind of expectations, and now he's putting his whole platform on what he started. We see it with sports stars, that their career-setting year can change everything for them, what team they are on, how much they're worth, everything. And now we see it with Susan Boyle. You know, Susan Boyle actually became so famous that she grew up in a village, she was a laundry woman, she was not anything. And all of a sudden, a month later, she's famous and traveling, and the pressure was too much for her, so she quit. She couldn't handle it. But people still want her to go. She's so well known for this course-setting moment that it's hard for her to even get out of it. We see that people, when they set a course, it's what you can expect after that. So, this is Jesus preaching, and this sermon has a few unique points to it, and I want to point those out. The first one is, in Jewish culture, it's similar to the Catholic Church today, they had a teaching, a scripture that they would preach or teach on. That would be the center of what they were going to teach that week, okay? We see it with Jesus. He actually goes in the synagogue and he reads something from Isaiah, and then he says, this scripture has been fulfilled in your presence today. The reason that it was important that he said that was because it was actually what they were teaching in the synagogue that day. And also, you can imagine, like, let's say I went up to Dr. Taves, he's one of my teachers. If I ask him, you know, what does the 2300 days, you know, what's the best verse to prove the 2300 days? He could not then go and say something about baptism. It would make no sense, right? If I ask a question, you're kind of stuck within a category of things you can say, right? So this is Jesus's first sermon that was not in a synagogue, which would kind of limit what he could teach about. And it was not an answer to a question. We see Jesus before this sermon answering a lot of questions. And he's in public, but it's not what he wanted to say. It's an answer to question. And this is a true exposition of Jesus' teachings then. Because it's what he wants to say with his own emphasis, with his own order and everything. This is Jesus' teaching. And as I mentioned before, it's to his disciples. There's the multitude, like I said, and then there's our five disciples here, or the 12 disciples, we might say. And it's important to point that out because it gives you a expectation of why he's doing it. But the question I have is, if Jesus starts with such an incredible sermon, Ellen White actually makes a statement that strongly implies that if you were to understand Matthew 5, 6, and 7, you could basically understand the gospel in its entirety through those three chapters. Okay, so this is a big deal, this Sermon on the Mount. And this is how Jesus starts it. The question is, does it have the same impact on us today? How does Jesus, he's not walking around, we're not going to find him on any mountains. How does he start with us today in this church, in our lives, with our problems? How does that happen? I want to point out a small, and I'm not going to go big into this, but this is part of setting the table, okay? It says this in Romans 1, 19 and 20. You can also find a similar thing in Romans 2. It says, for since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood through what has been made so that they are without excuse. This is Paul talking about people understanding who God is. Okay, we have a certain, and I actually learned this from Dr. Table, he emphasized it to my mind. People can be judged based on what they know, even if they don't know the name of Jesus. Okay, and the reason is because God doesn't leave them. We can think through this logically. If Jesus is going to reach every tribe, every tongue, and every nation, what about Chinese people in the 1200s before there was any gospel there? In some remote village in the middle of nowhere. Did they have a chance to know who God was? Jesus said it this way. He says, if I am lifted up, then I will draw all men. Does it say some men? Most men? The majority? No, all men to myself. He also breathed out and his spirit went out into the world. And Paul here is saying that in nature, we can see it in the love of a mother to her child, or in the beauty of a flower on the hill. In a grand landscape, we can see the majesty that is something bigger than ourselves. So this course-setting moment, this understanding of who God is that we all are stuck with, is something that we can all understand to at least a degree. We as Adventists like to call it general revelation and special revelation. We all have general revelation to some degree. We've seen God in this world, and we are held accountable to that. And praise the Lord that we have the word, right? We know who Jesus is and what he's done for us. So Jesus wants to give us a process, I believe. As I've looked at how Jesus started this sermon, something really bumped into my mind that made this all make sense. I grew up non-Adventist, non-Christian, and so trying to understand the Beatitudes seemed like trying to find random needles in a haystack. just random, what does that mean? I don't know. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Okay, I don't know. What does that mean? So from sermons of other people, from my dad, from my own study, I think I've come to an understanding of how this kind of works out together. And we're going to start here. Jesus, speaking to a group of Jews, says the most crazy thing to start a sermon. When you start a sermon, that's kind of how you get people's attention. Jesus did a good job. He was speaking to Jews. Being rich and being Jewish was a big deal. If you were a rich Jew, you were basically in heaven. You were a shoo-in. You were going in. It meant that God blessed you because you were somehow holier. That means you were blessed because of your holiness, and that's why you were rich, and you were a Jew, so you were a son of Abraham. You were in. But Jesus says this. He says, blessed are the poor in spirit. I just came back from Honduras. I've been in Honduras for the past I've been back here for 3 months, but before that I was in Honduras for 9 months, okay? So it's been about a year journey for me. When I was in Honduras, I learned a lot of things. And one thing I learned is that poverty is measured in two ways. One way is just basic human need. If a child doesn't have food, it doesn't matter to that child how much clothing they have. If that child ended up on a deserted island and he had his parents were rich and they had tons of clothes in lots of suitcases, but he had no food, that child would still be poor, yes? Because there's a basic human need that we all recognize that we can't live without. That would make that child poor. There's also another way of saying what poverty is. Poverty is relative, okay? When I went to Honduras and I walked the streets with my nice clothes, with my great education, with the fact that I just traveled across part of the world to get there, and I saw children who had never left that village, who their house was literally a piece of metal under the house of someone else where their sewer went between their living room, and they were there because they had no chance of getting out, I realized that the fact I grew up in a trailer court did not make me poor. Okay? You see, I realized that there is a certain relativity to poverty. I was not poor. Those people are poor. They're so poor that unless they get help or a miracle happens, they will be poor, period, the rest of their life. That's what real poverty is. So there are two types of poverty. There's a basic need that all of humanity recognizes. That means you're poor. You don't have food. You don't have clothes. You don't have water. You're poor. Somewhere to live. You're poor. Or relative to someone else. I then, right after, this was actually an interesting experience for me. I left Honduras, and literally 4 days later, I got in my car, and I drove to Southern California in the Loma Linda area for my best friend. He's right there. His wedding. Oh, look at them. They're so cute together. Aw. They're happy together. I was at their wedding, and I have to tell you, I went from Honduras, where the very nicest neighborhoods didn't have paved roads, to Southern California, where there are poor people there. I'm not saying everyone's rich, but I'm saying generally people are living it up very comfortably. They have a good life. And when I was there, I felt relatively poor. I felt like my car, which I love, wasn't really that nice. And it was amazing. 4 days later, coming from Honduras, where I was king of the castle, to all of a sudden, I had nothing. Poor is a very relative thing. But the question to me is, if I'm poor in spirit, who are we relating that to? Blessed are the poor in spirit. If it's a relative thing, or if it's a basic need thing, who says what someone needs spiritually? Well, we as Christians know the answer to that. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, the life. Spiritual things are spiritually discerned. Things of the flesh are of the flesh. We see that as Christians, we know that spiritual things are from God, that God gives us himself, and that's the only thing that makes us eternal even, right? Is the love and the power of God in us. Holy things and spiritual things are from God. So, if I'm spiritually poor, and poor is mostly a relative thing or a basic needs thing, how do I recognize my need or my poverty? I look at Jesus. Blessed are the poor in spirit. The only way you're going to know that you're poor, the only way that you're going to relatively see that you're poor, is if someone else has more than you do. Make sense? So I come to Jesus, or I come to his people that are sanctified with his spirit inside of them, and I say, wow, that person, that Jesus, that way more patient than I am, way more forgiving than I am, way more understanding, way more powerful and loving than I am, when I look at that Jesus and I compare him to myself, I say, I'm poor. I'm broken. I'm spiritually in need. Amen? But then it goes on. It says, blessed are those who mourn. I just mentioned that I went to my best friend's wedding, and I can tell you what I didn't see there. I didn't see anyone in the back pew just crying how sad they were. That didn't happen. And Emilian would have been, I gotta say, Emilian, you were crying a little bit, but I think it was tears of joy, at least I hope. Okay. So, there was no one crying their tears of mourning. That would make sense at a wedding, because mourning is something we do at the sense of loss, right? When family members die, or when we hurt someone that we love and we wish we could just take it back, but that moment's over, and we're mourning. That's what mourning's about, right? Blessed are the poor in spirit, because they look at God and they say, wow, that is a powerful, good, loving God, and I have nothing compared to him, which causes me to mourn my position, my sinfulness, my lack of ability to love those that I want to love, to follow through as I wish I could. So when we turn to God, we will mourn at some point, because we'll see our lack. We'll see our brokenness, because it's there. But he goes on. He says, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Amen? And then he says, blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. You see, Jesus knows that when we come into his presence, we're going to sense our lack. But you see, Jesus doesn't leave us there. He comes and he comforts us in our brokenness. He helps us. He makes us more than we would be on our own. But then it goes on even more. Blessed are those who humble, for they shall inherit the earth. You know, humility is not as some Christians have confusedly thought it was. It's not letting everyone walk over you. It's not making yourself a martyr in every argument, or just taking the back seat because you feel like, well, that's the humble thing to do. True humility is this. I look at Jesus, and I see how incredible he is, and the things he's done in his people, and how he follows through, and he never gives up, and he is there for me, which makes me mourn my state, my brokenness, and it makes me recognize my true position before him. Amen. You see, humility is something you cannot make yourself be or make yourself have. You cannot be humble on your own. Let's say Emilian and I were in Romania, okay? That's where Emilian's from. And he is better than me at speaking Romanian. If humanity were the only thing we were judging ourselves off, if the only thing that I understood value was how I relate to Emilian, when I was in Romania, I would feel less than him. And the reason is because I would be. He's actually better than me at that thing. He's actually more than I am when we're in Romania. So he would not, on his own accord, be able to say, I feel humble around Josh. Does that make sense? Because he actually would be better than me at that. He would actually be lying if he was to pretend to be humble. When you actually believe you're better than someone, you can't make yourself humble. You can act humbly. You can do humble things, but you cannot actually be humble. Because in your inward being, you know you're better. Right? So, I come before a holy God who says, blessed are the poor in spirit, because they see God for who he is. They mourn their sin, their brokenness, and they see themselves as they truly are. From dust you came, into dust you will return. Solomon said it, we're like a mist or a vapor. If we see ourselves before a holy God, that is the only way we'll truly be humble. because we know that God is so greater than I am, so much more than I am, and it will truly change our hearts and will really be humble and forgiving and understanding. And Jesus goes on, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. There's another thing I learned in Honduras. Poverty is a bad thing. Can we say amen to that? Poverty is a bad thing. You see, when a child is starving to death because every day I choose to go to Starbucks and not help anyone, that is a bad thing. That is not an okay thing. That is a bad thing. And it's the same spiritually. When someone is spiritually poor, they're in pain. They're suffering. They're confused. They're without direction. It's a bad thing. And if I recognize that I'm in that position, it would be natural. It would be healthy for me to become humble, to mourn my position, and to want to change. Right? Because if God is really good, then I don't want to be the opposite of that. I want to hunger and thirst for righteousness. I want him to fill me. I want to not be just selfish and sinful and broken, right? So, blessed are the poor in spirit, because they'll mourn their position, they'll become humble, and then they'll want to change. And you know what it says? For they shall be satisfied. It doesn't just say, I'll give you a little bit. Oh, here's a little breadcrumb. Nope. You'll be satisfied. Yeah. You'll sense fullness. And Jesus promised he would do that. But it goes on. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. You know, mercy's a really hard thing to give sometimes. Because mercy implies that the person actually deserves the thing that you're not doing. Grace is this. Grace is what God gives us, right? It's something free, something we haven't earned, right? It's him giving us something we don't deserve. Mercy is us not doing something someone does deserve. So, if I'm being merciful, that means I'm not doing something that it would be normal for me to do. Just like Jesus did to us, right? But what would cause someone to do that? Why would I find it in my heart to be merciful? And when I see someone hurting me and I want to be merciful and I can't find it in my heart and I don't really honestly care that much, how can I change that in my heart? Well, I go to God. Blessed are the poor in spirit because they see who God is. And they mourn their position before him, their brokenness, their sinfulness. They become humble, and he fills them with righteousness. And then I can say, truly, you know what? That person who just did that thing to me, they're really no worse than I am. I'm a sinful person. I've hurt people. I've broken relationships. I've lied to people just like they're doing to me. Jesus actually told a parable about this. He told about a very rich man, we could call him the king, a very rich man who someone owed this rich man a lot of money, and he forgave that man all the money he owed. The man who was forgiven then turns to his servant who only owed him a small amount of money, and he won't forgive him. He actually sends him to jail and says, you're gonna stay there until you pay up everything. The king is over here, and he says, how can you do that? I have forgiven you everything, and yet you won't forgive your servant this small amount? Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. You see, when I see my brokenness, and I see the sin that's inside of me, it's only natural for me to say, you know, I'm gonna let this one go. It's okay. Jesus has filled me with all I need. I'm going to let this one go. And he goes on. He says, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. All of us know what the word gospel means, right? Raise your hand if you know what the word gospel means. It's the good news. The reason it's called good news is because it's the thing everyone wants to hear. And it's that Jesus came and was merciful to us, right? It's basically the gospel in totality is mercy. Jesus has mercy on us, and then he gives of himself, which is grace. Right? Okay, so let me ask you this. If that's what we could say is the foundation of the gospel, it also says this in another place. Seek justice and love mercy humbly with your God, right? Well, let's say I'm walking through the woods. I'm just wandering, and I'm seeking justice, okay? But the whole time, I love mercy. I'm seeking justice, and I love mercy. Which one of those things is more foundational for me? The justice or the mercy? I'm seeking justice, but I love mercy. Mercy's actually the thing that I love, that I'm resting upon, that is the very foundation of who I am. And God tells us to be that way. So let's say that you have seen God and you've become humble and he's changed you and you've been filled with his grace and now you're being merciful to others. I can tell you something. You have got Jesus living inside of you because it's the only way you'll truly be merciful. If light and darkness don't live together and God is the very definition of purity, isn't it interesting that right after the merciful, we have the pure in heart? So those who are merciful, who have got the love of God inside of them, are becoming pure. Jesus' motives, his way of living, is becoming part of their very nature, their very fabric. And over time, you will become pure. As Jesus lives inside of you, Chris Blake likes to say it this way, sins are not tweezed out, but they are squeezed out. Sins are not tweezed out, they are squeezed out. As Jesus lives inside of us, when we become more merciful, we'll naturally become more pure. Amen? Amen. And he doesn't just stop there. He says, you will see God, because a holy thing cannot be around an unholy thing. So he makes us pure so that we can be with him. But he goes on, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Now I'm going to say this, and don't stone me. I have done yoga before. Yeah. Yoga, super manly, I know, okay? Yoga does make you feel better than you did before you did it. So let's say I'm having a really stressful day. I do some yoga, you know? And then afterwards, I'm like, oh, man, I feel better. I feel my muscles are all relaxed. I'm all flexible now. I'm all healthy, okay? Yoga actually is effective, but yoga doesn't change what's going on in here or in here. Yoga doesn't change how I see the world. Yoga doesn't change the stresses that are in my life. Yoga doesn't change the fact that I hate half the people around me. Yoga doesn't change those things. So I may feel great for half an hour and then the endorphins wear off. You know what happens? I'm back where I started. I gotta do yoga again. It's a lot of yoga. No one has time for that. So you know what you do? You turn to Jesus. You see how good he is. And you ask him, you become thirsty, hunger and thirst for righteousness, and he fills you, right? And over time, you start being merciful, and all of a sudden, you're pure in heart. In other words, God is living inside of you. The Holy Spirit is changing your very being. And when you walk into a place, there is peace. Many of us know these type of people. Not all of us, but most of us have them. We have a grandma, we have a dean from school, or maybe a teacher that we really loved. Someone who, when we were around them, we just loved being in their presence. They were just so loving and so kind and so understanding. And it seemed like their world was crazy as mine, but they were fine. Those are the kind of people that we might call peacemakers. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Because that's what Jesus came to do to this world, eventually. It's hard now, but one day Jesus will come and there will be no more tears or crying or pain, for the old things have passed away, and behold, all things have become new. And we're living in a peace again. So Jesus calls us to be peacemakers, but we can only do it as we turn to him. And then it goes on, blessed are those who have been persecuted for the sake of righteousness. I am not a third or fourth or 27th generation Adventist. My biological family is not at all Adventist. And when I was in high school, you guys get to know a little bit about me. That's cool, okay? When I was in high school, I met a pastor's family, and I was a lot like the pastor, so he kind of took me under his wing. He didn't technically adopt me, but I call him dad, okay? If that makes sense. So, my family that is my biological family, sometimes they don't really understand my way of life. They don't really understand why I don't eat pork, why I go to church on Sabbath, why I don't cuss or drink or smoke or lie to my friends or spend my money on gambling or da-da-da. It just goes on and on. Things that they do that I don't do, or things I do that they don't do. And you know what sometimes happens? I have to stand up. My mom was a recovered alcoholic. Praise the Lord, he worked in her life. She was a non-drinking alcoholic for 7 years. She went to school, she became a counselor, she was making great progress. And you know what happened? She decided that she really wasn't an alcoholic. They didn't really have a control of her life. She could handle just a couple drinks. That happened about a year ago. She still hasn't lost her job yet, but I can just watch and I can just see this downward slope in her life. It's because she's choosing the alcohol over God, which she is a Christian. She claims to be a Christian. She knows what's right, but she's choosing her alcohol over that thing. And you know what I've done? I've said, Mom, I love you. You're the only mom I'll ever have. You were the best mom I could have ever asked for. God put you in my life. But Mom, I will not support your drinking. Period. That's not going to change. I will talk to you. I will love you. I will spend time with you. But I cannot let you kill yourself and pretend like it's okay. I will not do that. You can pretend. You can have all the fun you want. But I'm not going to support this. And you know what that's done to our relationship? She has chosen the alcohol in a lot of ways over me. That's something I might call persecution. You see, because as God has worked in my life, I've seen the goodness of his ways. I've seen that I can trust his ways, that I don't want to do what sin does. I don't want to be that way. I want to live like him, and I want my family to also. But that means that they might choose the other way. And light and darkness do not mingle. It just doesn't work. You can try, but you're going to argue, you're going to fight. And that's in a very mild way. We all know that one day it's going to get worse in the United States, and we're going to have to stand up for what we believe. It's not going to happen because we're a bunch of angry people that are just yelling at everyone. No, it's going to happen because everyone wants to sin. And if I say, I'm not going to sin, and I don't support your sin, they're going to say, well, then you don't support me, so you're done. That's what's going to happen. And it's not going to be easy. That's why you're blessed. And that's why Jesus says the next part. He says this, blessed are those who have been persecuted for the sake of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Who needs to know that they have a kingdom waiting for them than those who just lost everything? It's interesting. Yeah. Jesus says it twice, actually. He says it to two groups of people, and he says it in a certain location. I want you all, raise your hand if you have a Bible. Actually, lift up your Bible if you have it with you. Lift it up. Now, I want you to look at Matthew 5. Turn to Matthew 5, because I want you to notice something. And you probably know this already, but I'm going to make you look just for those who don't know. Matthew 5, we're going to look at verse 3 to 10. You'll notice that every single time it says this, blessed are blank, for they blank. Blessed are these people, for they blank. Right? Blessed are for they. Blessed are for they. We go like that all the way from verse 3 through 10. How many of you guys in your Bible, it's kind of written in a different way than the rest of the page? Like it's all just normal paragraphs, and then that part, it's kind of, like you can, I don't know if you can see mine, it's kind of poetic looking. It kind of is indented and stuff. That's because the person who edited that Bible saw what I'm trying to point out. Verses 3 through 10 say, blessed are these people, for they. And then verse 11 is actually just an emphasis or a repeat of verse 10. Okay? It's bringing out an important part of being persecuted. But Jesus, in this part, he wants 3 through 10 is actually a set. It goes together. It's a poem. Okay? Now, poetry is something that is beautiful, and part of poetry is the way it's structured. Right? We know who's blessed because Jesus says, blessed are they, and then he gives us a reason every time. And we know after he says blessed, there's a reason. And then he says blessed, and then there's a reason. Let's read verse 3. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. We go through blessed, 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 and then verse 10. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake. For what? Theirs is the kingdom of heaven. When you look at this Bible, you'll notice something about it. It has two sides. It has a front and it has a back. The reason you know that this is one book, or at least it all goes together, it all has something related to it, is because it has bindings. It's not just a bunch of random pages. I don't carry it around like this. Oh, hey guys, let's go to church. That wouldn't work very good. No. It has it together like this. So you know it all goes together. Jesus did the same thing. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And you go through the whole process of being a Christian. Sometimes you're recognizing your sinfulness and you're mourning your position before God. And you feel broken and you feel not good enough and you feel like you'd rather be anywhere else in the world and you really just wish you could just zap it all away and be perfect like Jesus. Sometimes you're going to be humble and you're going to see yourself as you truly are and God's going to do things through you and it's going to be a ride of your life. Sometimes you're going to be hungering and you're going to be thirsting. Sometimes you're going to be pure in heart and you're going to recognize that God is inside of you. You're going to sense this safety, this security. But I want you to know that maybe you're over here and you're mourning in this part of your life and you feel like you're really just not good enough. But you've turned to God. I can tell you, if you recognize you're sinful, it's only because the Holy Spirit's told you so. And if you follow that, you're on this pathway. And maybe you're here. Maybe you're being merciful. Or maybe you're being persecuted because of the righteousness that's inside of you. But from there to here, yours might be the kingdom of heaven. Is that what it says? Yours is the kingdom of heaven. Praise the Lord. Amen? Amen? You see, Jesus had a sure way. And it starts like this. You look to Jesus, and he'll change you. And yours is the kingdom of heaven. Amen. Let's pray. God, I want to thank you for who you are. I want to thank you that you have a plan in our lives. That you know how to work in each heart. That although we are tired sometimes, although I know I wish I was better at being like you, and although people hurt us because maybe they're not as good at being like you as they should be, God, I know that you're patient, that you're loving. Your word says that love never fails. So Lord, may we look at that love. May we look at that cross, that life that you lived, that you rose and conquered death, that you're coming back again. These are hopes that we lean on because we really recognize our poverty, that we have nothing else. God, work in us. Make us like you. Make us a light on a hill that the world can see you. In your holy, beautiful, and powerful name, amen. Amen. I think that's it.
Stand.
All to Jesus I surrender. Now to him I freely give. I will. to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all to Jesus. I surrender humbly at his feet. I bow, worldly pleasures all forsaken. Take me, Jesus, take me now. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all. All to Jesus, I surrender. Make me Savior, holy thine. Let me feel the Holy Spirit. Truly know that thou art mine. I surrender all. I surrender. Surrender now. I feel the sacred flame. Oh, the joy of full salvation! Glory, glory to his name. I surrender all. I surrender.
Let's pray. God, may we surrender all. Work in our hearts. Help us see you for who you are and turn to you. God, we are so thankful that you're faithful, that you're always there when we turn, and you just want to be with us. You've done so much to show that. I just pray that we'll let go of our fears and our doubts. That maybe we've let you in the front door of our house, but let's let you in every part of the house. Let you change us, the way we live and the way we sleep, with peace and knowledge of your care. Thank you, God. In your holy name, amen.